Thank you so much. What talent we have in this church, isn't it? On this Sunday, let us stand and sing Crown Him with Many Crowns. It's number 327. It's also the dentist's favorite hymn.
Oh. is Christ the King Sunday. Everybody go, woo! Woo! All right, you'll hear that theme in our music today, Christ the King. It's officially called the Feast of Christ the King. It's also referred to as the Solemnity of our Lord Jesus Christ, King of the Universe. I like that title. It's a wonderful day. It's a Catholic feast day. It celebrates the full authority of Christ as King and Lord of the universe. The first Feast of Christ the King was instituted by Pope Pius XI in 1925. I didn't realize till I was doing a little research that it was that recent, roughly 100 years ago. But it's celebrated throughout the universal church. The feast day was in response to the increasing denial of Christ as King and the rise of secularism in Europe. During this period, many Christians, including Catholics, were doubting Christ's authority, some even doubting Christ's existence. They were also, of course, denying the church's power to continue Christ's authority. So authority of the church, authority of Christ, it was kind of waning. This was also a time when dangerous dictatorships were emerging in Europe and beyond. And so Pope Pius XI and other faithful Christians, as they began to see the respect and the reverence for Christ's authority diminishing, they put this feast in place just to kind of reaffirm the respect, reestablish the respect in the kingship and authority of Jesus Christ. The feast was originally celebrated on the final day of October, the day before All Saints' Day. Pope Paul VI moved the feast to the last Sunday before Advent in 1969 to kind of set it apart from other feasts and kind of highlight its importance. So that would fall in November most years. Churches that use the Revised Common Lectionary honor Christ the King Sunday as the final Sunday of the liturgical year. I was in seminary before I understood that we had a liturgical year that differed from the calendar year. But once I learned it, it made a lot of sense to me. And so this is actually the last Sunday of the liturgical year, because the Christian year begins with Advent. Right. So that it kind of made sense once somebody shared that with me. But today is the last Sunday then for us of this liturgical year. Next Sunday with Advent, we'll begin a new year. This is riveting stuff, I know, right? Okay. Let's turn to a familiar scripture where Jesus actually confirms the fact that he is a king. Our first scripture today comes from the 18th chapter of John. When Jesus stood trial before Pilate, Pilate asked him point blank. He said, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus responds with his own question. "Is that your own idea? Or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "Your own people and chief priests handed you over to me. What is it that you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," Pilate said. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying that I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." Would you read that verse again with me? "Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." It's a good verse, isn't it? Everyone on the side of truth listens to Jesus. Pilate asked him a straightforward question. Jesus answered him clearly. Jesus is a king, but his true kingdom is not here. His true kingdom is a heavenly kingdom. But there seems to me, as you read the accounts in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there seems to have been little doubt in Pilate's mind that Jesus is telling the truth. He is who he says he is. He's innocent of any crime. But while recognizing the truth, we fault Pilate because he chose not to act defense of it. He accepted the truth. He just didn't act on what he accepted, what he recognized. While recognizing the truth, he chose not to act in defense of it. Maybe it was out of cynicism. You know, his next question to Jesus, in according to John, is, what is truth? Right? You have a truth. I have a truth. Everybody has their own truth. Right? Maybe it was cynicism. Maybe it was concern for his own position and his own power. Maybe that was the reason he chose not to defend Jesus, but to hand him over for crucifixion. He did try. If it had been easy to get Jesus off the hook, to release him, Pilate might have done it, right? We do like the easy path, the path of least resistance. We don't want to get in trouble for standing for truth. For some people, and I suspect Pilate was one of them, truth is relative, right? It can shift, it can fluctuate, it depends on the desired outcome. For some government officials in Jesus' time, the truth was whatever the majority of people agreed with or whatever helped advance their own personal agendas and elevate their position and increase their power. Truth was indeed a relative commodity, right? How much have things changed in 2,000 years? When there is no basis for truth, there's no basis for moral right and wrong. Justice becomes whatever works, whatever's effective, whatever helps those in power. So what does Jesus mean when he tells Pilate that everyone on the side of truth listens to me? I think Jesus is saying that he is the standard for truth. He is the truth. His teachings are the basis for moral right and wrong. That's what Christians believe, isn't it? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He is all those things. The standard for truth and for our moral behavior lies in Jesus and his word, the scriptures. The standard for our moral behavior. Sometimes we measure ourselves against each other, don't we? Well, I'm not that bad. You know, I'm not great, but I'm better than they are, right? I'm better than that person. I'm better than that person. I'm doing better than that person. But that's not really the measure of our faithfulness, right? We should measure ourselves against Jesus and his word. Follow Jesus and his teachings, and you will learn the truth. It may take a while. You know, you'll have to ponder. But you will learn the truth. You'll learn how to apply it. That's where I think it gets sticky. It's not understanding what he says. It's how to apply it to everyday life, right? Do I choose this path or that path? Do I go this way or this way? What do I do in this situation? But what do I do in this situation? What do I do now? What do I do tomorrow? If you follow Jesus, if you learn the word, if you learn to walk closely with him, all through your life, you will make mistakes. Hate to tell you that. We're human. You will make some mistakes, but you will grow more grounded in the truth, okay? Not a truth, but the truth, his truth, okay? The one that matters. You'll grow more grounded in it, and you'll learn how to apply it in one situation after another in your life. It does get easier with practice, as all things do, right? It gets a little easier with practice. There will still be situations that confound you, and you'll pray a lot over them, and you'll still not be sure what to do. That's all right. Jesus is still with you. Everyone on the side of truth, that just really grabbed me this week, listens to Jesus. Everyone on the side of truth listens to Jesus. It is a tragedy when people fail to recognize the truth. It is a greater tragedy when they recognize the truth and choose not to abide by it. So what kind of a king is Jesus? He said to Pilate, "You're right in saying I'm a king, but my kingdom's not of this world." When Jesus said that his kingdom was from another place, I think it might have been a little bit of a surprise to Pilate, but I suspect it was a great disappointment to some of his followers. You know, what do you mean you're not a king of right here and now? What do you mean? We need a king. They were anticipating an earthly king, somebody to overthrow the Roman rule and be the earthly king of Israel, somebody from the tribe of Judah and the lineage of David and the town of Bethlehem. And Jesus checked a lot of those boxes off, right? Except the kingship one was surprising. There's a beautiful scripture in Revelation, chapter 19. I love this scripture. And it talks about, it's this beautiful part of the vision that John has. And he sees Jesus. It's an amazing vision of Jesus. We're going to look at the scripture in just a minute. But it's not Jesus as the Lamb. He saw Jesus as the Lamb. He had a vision of that, the Lamb that was sacrificed for the sins of the world. That's what John called him. Behold, the Lamb of God who will take away the sins of the world. That is one image of Jesus. But John, in chapter 19, he has another vision of Jesus. And this time, he's a warrior on a white horse. This is a cool scripture. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and what? True. With justice, he judges and wages war. What? His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dripped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. This is an image for Jesus, okay? The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword. We already saw that earlier in Revelation. Again, Jesus has this sword in symbolically in his mouth with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has the name written. Read that with me. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's such a cool image of Jesus. It's kind of surprising, isn't it? That's not how we usually picture our meek and mild leader. Jesus, our spiritual king, coming a second time. John says this time in judgment. It's a great image. It's a beautiful and I would say encouraging image for Christians, but it is somewhat intimidating and fear-producing for others. Okay? If you don't know Jesus and you see him at the second coming, it'll be time for a little bit of nervousness, okay? But it is a powerful image of Jesus as our King. Maybe a little unsettling to some, but it's a powerful image. I think it's a neat image. Let's shift gears and talk about the duties of a king. What does a good king do? What? Well, a good king protects the kingdom, right? And all of the people in it, including the most vulnerable within it, the poor. A good king cares for all of his people. And even during his brief years on earth, even though this wasn't his ultimate kingdom, you saw Jesus doing this and more, right? You saw him teaching his people. You saw him trying to protect them and heal them and care for the least and the last and the lost. He was very focused on the poor and the marginalized during his earthly ministry. He taught his disciples to help those in need without judgment. Jesus modeled that for them. Help people without judgment. It's very important. A lot of us help people, right? But we don't do it without judgment. Oh, we have to learn that. We have to learn that. The disciples had to learn that. He taught them to help those in need without judgment, to welcome everybody, to demonstrate love and build healthy community. And Jesus warned his disciples about ignoring or neglecting those in need. Our third scripture today is from Matthew chapter 25, and in Matthew's gospel, it's Jesus' last sermon. Okay, so it must be pretty good, right? I know whenever I leave a church, I work on that final message because I'm trying to leave pearls of wisdom, right? So that's going to be a really good sermon. So this is Jesus' last chance with the disciples to impart to them some great pearls of wisdom. And this is what he says. He talks about the final judgment. And he says, when the Son of Man comes in glory, and that is a reference in Matthew that Jesus uses for himself. Okay, so he is the Son of Man. When the Son of Man comes in glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. Why? Because he's a king, right? He'll sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he'll separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. Do you know this story, this sermon? He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? I like this. See, they're a little bit confused. The disciples are asking him that. They're a little bit confused because sometimes Jesus speaks to them in parables, right? And sometimes he uses allegory. He's using an example. He doesn't mean it literally. Sometimes Jesus means it literally. So they're trying to figure out, you know, Lord, they're taking it literally. We saw you, Jesus, and we helped you. No, I don't know. When did we see you and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. And then it dawns on him. All the good things that they've been doing for others in his name counts. Just like you were doing it for Jesus. Did he really mean that, literally? Then Jesus will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not invite me. I needed clothes and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you did not look after me. They also will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and didn't help you? Jesus, we would always respond to you if you had a need. He'll reply, truly, I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you didn't do for me. Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. Whew, well, I'm not sure if he'd get, 12 thumbs up for that sermon. I don't know. But this is called the final judgment. Apparently from Jesus' perspective, and again, we're establishing that his perspective is really the one that counts, right? So from Jesus' perspective, salvation is more than just responding emotionally at a revival or saying yes at confirmation or declaring I was born again on June 25th or whatever the date is. Those are all good things. They are all good moments. But there is a doing. There is an action. There is a whole lifestyle shift that comes when we follow closely to Jesus. When we have that emotional moment, when we say yes to Jesus and accept him as our Lord, Savior, and King, oh, that is a beautiful moment. Yes, it is profound. It is marvelous. But what follows is a whole lot more. A complete transformation begins. As we begin to follow him, everything begins to change. How we see ourselves shifts a little bit. How we see others shifts a little bit. Lord, is that you? How we see the pain in the world. And we're wired differently, right? Some of us are very touched when we see children in need. Some of us are drawn to older adult ministries. Some of us are drawn to prison ministries. It's okay, but we shift a little bit and we see the pain of the world in some way a little bit deeper because of our walk with Jesus. Things begin to change. How we think we can make the world different. Where we think we can plug in and make a difference. We gain confidence. We gain conviction. We gain competence. We gain compassion. Everything begins to change. How we spend our money begins to matter more. What causes we support matters. What we do with our time matters. We begin to volunteer for things and programs and places and activities. We begin to think that we can make a difference. We can help. We can love. We can connect. We can share. We can challenge. We can lead. We can serve. We can care. Right? When we walk closely to Jesus, we change. Maybe prison ministry calls to you. Maybe you volunteer at a local food pantry. Maybe you bring food. I know a lot of you do, because every week we take a bunch of food to the local food pantry. Bless you. Maybe the local homeless shelter is something that's important to you, or the senior citizens center, or our new overnight warming location. Where's Lucas? Right, Lucas? All right. Lucas and I have volunteered for the OWL. I like that. They're calling it the OWL, overnight warming location. When the temperature in Edwardsville drops to 20 degrees or lower, the First Baptist Church in Edwardsville will open its gymnasium. Lucas and I and others will go, and we will host people for the evening. They'll get a meal. They'll get a shower if they want it. They'll get clothing if they need it. They'll have a place to stay out of the cold for a night. The temperature goes back up. Out they go for the morning. If the temperature dips, you can come back the next day. But I think that's cool, don't you? I think that's cool. It's not a solution, but it's a start, right? How is it that you see the pain of the world? When we come to faith in Jesus Christ, it's like we begin to see what faith Jesus has in us, you know? And he puts people in front of us with needs that I would dare say he probably expects us to respond to, you know. And I have missed many such opportunities in my life. But I'm trying to get better at seeing them and recognizing them and coming up with some way to respond that will be beneficial. We begin to think that our efforts matter, however small. We don't worry about the problems in the whole world that we cannot change, but we realize that the whole problems in the world can be changed one life at a time. And so it's kind of a perspective shift. You don't lose sleep over everything, but you begin to see that it just takes one thing to cause a ripple effect. And God is a God of multiplication. I sleep very well at night, but I still struggle with things, problems, issues in the world. In the lives of the congregation, in the lives of our community. I struggle with that, but I sleep well, you know. When I wake up, I'll start struggling again, but I have good dreams, you know. I hope you do too. But when you begin to think that your efforts matter, however so small, when you begin to own that you can actually do something significant to share Jesus and to be a blessing to others in his name, it really is very empowering. It's very liberating. All right, back to Jesus' last sermon. There is some kind of connection between understanding who Jesus is and what he expects of us and beginning to care and serve other people. There's some kind of a connection there. Jesus said that there was. I know Martin Luther, the great church reformer of 1517, he said this in one of his theses. I think it was thesis number 45. He said Christians should be taught that those who see someone in need pass by and then give money for indulgences are not purchasing for themselves the Pope's indulgences, but rather God's anger. Luther didn't like the whole system of indulgence, okay? You can't just purchase a pardon and ignore the needs of the world. That was part of his issue. Mother Teresa made a life out of taking that passage in Matthew 25 seriously and actually doing it. She visited the sick. She went to those in prison. She fed the hungry. She clothed the naked. She befriended the lonely. And she had loving compassion on all. And she called it, I meant to put this on the screen for you, but I forgot. She called it the five-finger gospel. You did it to, I can't raise those fingers, me. You did it to me. You did it to me. That's the five-fingered gospel, according to Mother Teresa. You did it to me. Remember that every good deed done in the name of Jesus matters. It matters to the person, the recipient, and it matters to Jesus. I wonder if I could find somebody near me who is doing each of the things Jesus suggests. Whom do I know who's feeding the hungry and giving drink to the thirsty? Whom do I know who welcomes strangers in? Whom do I know who shares their clothing with others? Whom do I know who visits the sick? Whom do I know who visits those in prison? I bet they have a story to tell. People need to see these things in reality, up close and personally and really happening. I wonder if we had a set of sign-ups, real live opportunities, what would people, how would they respond? Come with us to the local food pantry at such and such an hour. Come join us for yoga Tuesdays at 10. Come help us deliver food to children after school so they'll have a meal or two over the weekend. Or maybe we could carpool to another church, maybe a local mosque for a hummus-making class with some new Muslim friends. Something, you know, something. The homeless rate in America is atrocious. Children in our own nation with food insecurity, the number of them that suffer with not enough food to eat and not healthy options, it's atrocious. I saw a news report yesterday, the latest figures from Al Jazeera about the Israeli-Gaza-Palestinian situation. 14,800 Palestinians have been killed in Gaza. In a little over a month. In Israel, the death toll from Hamas attacks stands at about 1,200. What can we do? What can I do to reflect the light of Christ into these dark places? What can we do? I bet Jesus has some ideas. Final scripture for this morning from Paul's letter to the church at Colossae. And now, just as you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord, you must continue to follow him. Let your roots grow down into him, and let your lives be built up on him. Then your faith will grow strong in the what? In the truth you were taught, and you will overflow with thankfulness. Amen. Don't forget the placemats up here. Larry, you may have one. All right. Any children, any grandchildren, come get them. Any teenagers, yes, you may have one too. Would you join me in our benediction, please? Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people, because all people are God's people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.